Last Sunday, a 1,585-foot-high megatsunami struck a portion of Alaska. You heard that correctly. 1,585 feet or 483 meters was the tsunami's maximum height. Thankfully, this event occurred in a very remote part of the state, so there were no deaths or injuries, with the only damage being some lost camping equipment and a kayak. And now, thanks to efforts by the US Geological Survey, I can show you firsthand photos of the devastation caused by this absurdly tall megatsunami. Do you see that brown line near the fjord bottom? That does not mark slowly regrowing areas uncovered after a recent glacial retreat, as instead, it marks the inundation that the tsunami reached. Each of those tiny green dots are a fully grown tree. The fjord bottom is at sea level or 0 feet altitude, while the top of the ridge with the tsunami inundation line rapidly rises to an altitude of 704 meters or 2,309 feet. So yes, that area was previously filled with vegetation a mere week ago before all of it was annihilated by an up to 1,585-foot-high wave that would have theoretically overtopped all but one skyscraper in New York City. Here's a closer view, looking towards the source of this record-breaking tsunami, a tan to gray scarp showing the source of the single largest landslide to strike all of Alaska in 67 years. Not only did this tsunami remove all vegetation in its path, but because of its sheer mass, it gouged the underlying rock and soil, in some areas removing house-sized chunks of material. This megatsunami formed when at 5:26 a.m. local time on August 10th, a series of preceding small failures of an unstable and steep slope in a glacially carved fjord culminated in a half-mile long, one-third of a mile wide, and up to 820-foot-deep portion of a mountainside collapsing all at once. The landslide initially involved what I estimated to be 57.86 million cubic meters of rock, which started falling with enormous potential energy from a height of 1,020 meters or 3,346 feet and was rapidly heading towards sea level. Within 15 seconds, while part of this massive volume of rock impacted the water in the deep fjord, the other half struck the outlying edge of the major South Sawyer Glacier. This broke apart a 58-acre area of the glacier, adding another 57.07 million cubic meters of material to the landslide. In mere moments, this all entered the water, and with more than 100 million cubic meters of rock and ice displacing the water, it caused it to lurch upwards and generate a truly towering wave. The very tallest wave was directly to the south-southwest of the landslide, the same direction that the landslide was moving horizontally. As the wave impacted nearby shorelines, it gouged additional holes in the landscape, removed vegetation, but also decreased in height. Regardless, by the time it had traveled 3.5 miles, the megatsunami was still above 100 meters or 328 feet tall. When this still decreasing wave struck the uninhabited Sawyer Island, every single piece of vegetation was removed except for two small patches of trees on the island's highest points. 12 miles away, topographic features combined to locally amplify the height of the tsunami, causing it to inundate a valley with up to 35-meter or 115-foot-high waves. By the time the tsunami had traveled 30 miles, part of it entered Williams Cove, running up 13 feet above sea level and wrecking vegetation. The wave that struck Harbor Island, which destroyed a kayak, was even taller, likely reaching a height of 16 feet in some spots. Then, after entering a more open body of water, the intensity of the tsunami rapidly decreased, only creating a 13-inch-high wave on the shorelines of Juneau, which caused no damage there. This landslide, which occurred 59 miles southeast of Juneau in the Treacy Arm, was surprisingly not the source of the tallest tsunami that has ever been recorded, just the second tallest. As the record-breaking tallest tsunami reached a height of 524 meters or 1,720 feet in Alaska's Lituya Bay due to a landslide-generated megatsunami on July 9, 1958. Both of these megatsunamis were created in a similar manner, albeit with different triggers due to the retreat of glaciers that were previously holding up otherwise unstable slopes. With these glaciers getting thinner and retreating backwards, eventually these bodies of ice were no longer holding up specific slopes, allowing large volume landslides to occur. This impressive landslide left the Tracy Arm filled with many large fragments of ice and debris such as tree trunks, whereas beforehand such pieces were only present at far lower concentrations. As a final note, I would like to thank my new YouTube channel member, Blue Destructor, for supporting my work.